Thank you for this nice introduction and also for giving me the floor. So what I want to express in the next 20, 25 minutes is also built on the work that has been performed by an important group of experts, of researchers within the STAR project, a project that was financed by the European Commission. And in the STAR project, there was a working group dealing with this issue of what are the challenges and what are the needs for integration of human and environment into a system of radiation protection. So I will go through, in my presentation, I will go through all the challenges and all the, let's say, the advantages that we also have if we want to integrate. Does that work? Okay, I'll see. Do it this way, that way. Yes. Okay. Why should we integrate? Because if we deal with environmental and human protection, because we are dealing with the environment, the same environment which is contaminated. If we integrate both human and environmental protection, we have it provide more coherent inputs for decision making in the decision making process. And it will also have then less contradictory afterwards when you have to come to this decision making. It also improves the quality and the efficiency of the assessment through the exchange of information between the people or the organizations that are dealing with human and environmental assessments, risk assessment. Also, very likely the scientific quality of the assessment is improved through a sharing of this information and also sharing of techniques between the two assessment frameworks. And also there will be, if there is interdependence, for example, between, let's say, how contamination of the environment may impact human health, but also vice versa, it will be considered. Impact of, for example, other stresses, they will be also considered almost in the same way or not be deconsidered in one or the other framework. So that we will have a more coherent and holistic view of the situation. And it's not only we inventing this. This is also something that was proposed by the World Health Organization already in 2005. Not for radioactivity, but for the conventional contaminants. So humans, in their consideration, and I think it's also important that humans, we are part of an ecosystem. We are one of the, maybe a special wildlife form, and we are part of the ecosystem. We are not just the end of the food chain. So, and there's also a two-way interaction. So we depend on the ecosystem for goods and services, like for agriculture, forestry, but also the enjoyment of walking in a park. But we will also impact an ecosystem. And not only through the pollution, but also if we perform agriculture, if we develop parks, we also impact on the ecosystem. So it's a two-way approach. And also, when the environment is contaminated, it may directly impact human health, but it may also be indirectly. If, for example, after Fukushima, there's a forest that's contaminated and you were normally used to go and pick mushrooms, and maybe there is not the really health hazard of going and picking mushrooms, there may be now some negative factor connected with it, whereas before it would only be enjoyment. So there is also, let's say, secondary effects that are maybe not always health-related, which are linked with the environment being contaminated. And this is also a framework which is developed not within the radiation protection framework, but as I said, also within the other contaminant framework or the chemical contaminant framework, so that we go for a more holistic focus. Now, if we look at risk assessment, in both cases, if we're dealing with human or environmental risk assessment, we start with the formulation of a problem. So we have there a source term. And that's contamination is traveling through the environment to a receptor, maybe man or wildlife. And then we try to assess the exposure. And to that exposure, we try to indicate a risk. And then, so the whole process is rather similar. And so because of the similarity, it also calls for this natural integration. Because in the end, if we have to have a, let's say, deal with all the risks together in order to come to an optimal decision-making, all these different factors have to be included. And if then, for example, in our assessments, we would take, for example, maybe different source term, maybe different parameters that we use within for determining the transfer of this radioactivity in the environment through its receptors, then that may be a kind of a clash, and we will not be coherent. So also there's certainly reason for more integration. But now we're going to look at these different steps, how easy and how difficult it will be to integrate. So I think it's rather justified that we integrate dispersion and transfer models. So we have radio-ecological data for human and environment risk assessment. So they underlie the dispersion and transfer in the environment. So that's in principle the same. And also the underlying physical and chemical processes are the same. If you have radium traveling towards whatever a mice or a mouse or traveling to whatever wheat, which then afterwards will be consumed by men, in a way the traveling of this of radium within the environment or transfer of radium in the environment is the same. So it would be logical to use the same activity concentrations from the start in the media and or the organisms for starting as a starting point, and it's also logical to use the same dispersion and transfer models. And this also exemplified, for example, in the IEA has developed the safety report series number 19. They are under, they're going to be improved and put in a different format. But the models which are within the safety report series number 19, they are also included within the ERICA tool so that in case you don't know how the dispersion of your radioactivity within the environment would be. Certainly for, let's say, rather tier 1 or tier 2 assessments, you can use these models. So there is also already within the ERICA tool this integration for dispersion and transfer pathways. But there is a challenge. So there is the data for the transfer parameter data for human impact assessment or human exposure assessment, they are rather plentiful. Relatively plentiful. And we also have quite some data for the transfer of radioactivity within the food chain, and also there's also quite some data of the uptake and depuration in human bodies and organs. But if we go to wildlife, the data are much more scarce for a wide range of species and of habitats. So we need much more extrapolation there. And also the concentration ratios which are used for human impact assessment and environmental impact assessment or wildlife impact assessment, it may be at this point less easy to harmonize. It should be possible that at this point there are some discrepancies. And for example, when we look at the concentration, if you have the uptake to fish from water bodies, then for human impact assessment we would look only at the edible part. But the real fish swimming in the water and looking at the impact to the fish, we really need to have the overall transfer to the fish, to the edible part, but also to the bone. So to have a good idea about the exposure of the fish. So we have a collection of transfer data. We have for human, we have the TRS 472 from the IEA. For non-human biota, we have 479. And there's concentration factors there for wildlife, for example, deer or freshwater fish, but they are different. And because we are looking at different, let's say, components of the animal when we are collecting these data. In the human food chain modeling, we have an exposure model which is linked with how much we eat of whatever substance. When we have wildlife, then we consider the concentration ratio, the concentration is defined as the concentration in the organism divided by the concentration in the medium, the water, the soil, without having all these different aspects of the food chain. So there is a difference. That doesn't mean that it is not that we cannot overcome this. And the same for the solid liquid distribution coefficients, so that's the repartitioning between the radioactivity between, for example, the water and the sediment phase. Also there is still some discrepancy. It has been, most of the data are updated now in the ERICA tool, but certainly in the initial phase there were discrepancies. So So these things, okay, this is how the situation is today, but they can be overcome. Because we think that even if today the transport processes are not really managed in the same way in the two systems, I think it's certainly amenable to integration. So we can really have a close look at these databases, at the dispersion processes, and we can come to an integrated approach. And I think that's also important, that, for example, if you're dealing with, for example, a legacy site, and there would be the environmental people looking at wildlife impact assessment, wildlife effects, and what another group of people looking at human impact assessment, and we would use different parameters, that would be very strange. So we have to, for credibility and for coherence, we have to harmonize there. So the next step is, how can we integrate dosimetry? That will be very likely much more challenging. Because for in human, the dosimetry is sophisticated, certainly sophisticated compared to what we have for wildlife. So we have, it's based on biokinetic models. We have organ and radiation, the biological effectiveness factors depending on the radiation quality. We have organ tissue specific, we have age specific, we have these voxel phantoms, so very detailed. For organisms, as Cathy also already said, we shape our environment. We shape our environment in ellipsoids. So, and we also think that, or we also consider that the distribution of the radioactivity is homogeneous. We also consider that these, for a fish, is immersed in an homogeneously contaminated medium. So we also have a dose rate which is averaged over the volume. So we have important simplification, but that's also needed because there is such a wide range of organisms out there that we cannot do but simplify. And only for a few rare cases, we can do a little bit differently. But on the other hand, there's also advances in wildlife dosimetry because, as we all know, the physics of interaction, they are the same if we are dealing with men or environment. But there are also some, for example, voxel models developed, they are mostly developed as a benchmark to see, okay, these simplified models that we use, how far are we off from reality? And therefore, these voxel models are certainly worthwhile. But to really integrate this within environmental risk assessment tools, this is not relevant because it would be too much effort for the gain that we would get from it. Then we have also, for men, we have rather detailed exposure models, and we have also different life age classes. But wildlife, we just take one small animal, a frog. So he has a lifetime history that starts within the water, and then they respire through its gills, and they eat more, let's say, herbal. They have more a herbal food system. When they then grow older and they come up to the surface, then they respire through their lungs and they become carnivorous. So how are we going to even get that detail within our impact assessment models? So it's not done. So we mostly have data which are dealing with the adult animal that has a certain lifestyle. So as I said, for men, it's rather well characterized. For wildlife, there's a lack of for most of the data for other species, both with respect to where they are residing and with respect to their, let's say, the different age classes or the life stages of an animal. These different life stages we are not going to take into account in the ERICA model as it is, or other models as it is today. It's mostly dealing with the adult life stages. And we also have to, for example, the approaches to calculate the biota committed effect is those that we is not available for wildlife. We will certainly not go that way. We can have specific cases where we will be able to model that, but it will not be integrated as for all the, let's say, for all the species. So it is very unlikely that we will be able to effectively integrate human and wildlife dose assessment, because to the same extent, to the same level of detail. Then there is another challenge, is with respect to the protection endpoints. There's different framework and different goals. And here I would like to quote ICRP. With the environment, it is mentioned that a negligible impact on the maintenance of biological diversity, the conservation of species, or the health and status of natural habitats, communities, and ecosystems. That's the aim, the goal of protection. For human health, it is the management and the control of exposures to ionizing radiation such that deterministic effects are prevented and the risk of stochastic effects are reduced to a reasonable, achievable level. So that means for environment, we focus on populations, ecosystem, if we have the data, very seldom on individuals when we have rare species or endangered species. For human, it's focused on individuals. So our endpoint is unlikely to be integrated, but can we integrate the frameworks? That has to be looked at. Regulatory limits and consideration levels. For human risk assessment, we have established those limits, those constraint reference levels. We have this for different types of situations. We aim to restrict individual doses, and we have benchmarks which have a biological basis. For environmental risk assessment, it is less well defined, and we don't have really limits. It's more like screening levels, and there is also no international agreement. Erika proposed a predicted no effect dose rate of 10 micrograms per hour. Screening out, if your dose rate would be below that 10 micrograms per hour, it would screen out the site. It would say, okay, this site, we can be pretty sure there will be no population or ecosystem effects. ICRP had those consideration reference levels, as explained by Cathy. USDOA, the IEA, they have other dose limits. So, and the values, I'm not saying that they are not grounded in science, but they are not so well grounded in science as for human risk assessment. So is it there feasible or is it desirable to integrate? Because the protection goals are different and there's a lack of data for effects to non-human species and also to ecosystem in general. Okay. Then there is also the challenge of extrapolation and uncertainties. There's many factors that contribute to uncertainties, as we already heard, I think also during the last 2 days, certainly with respect to human risk assessment. So how are we going to transfer from risk from one population to another, also dealing with people, because you also had, let's say, groups of people who would be more sensitive than others, for example. How do we extrapolate from acute to chronic, from high dose to low dose, and how do we extrapolate for different radiation types? For environmental risk assessment, additional uncertainty is that we have a large number of species and also ecosystems. But what we can learn, I think the two systems, they can learn from each other's extrapolation methods. And there's also a range of values that are often available for model parameters. Like, for example, we should also have kind of consistency and transparency between human risk assessment and environmental risk assessment. For example, the use of geometric means or PDFs, for example. Because also if we look at the IEA TRS 472 or in the TRS dealing with concentration ratios for wildlife, the data are also represented in another way. So there could also be some coherence in how we represent uncertainty around a mean. So this I'm going to leave. So integration, is that feasible? Is it needed? And initially we said there is integration is needed and it has a positive effect because it will have an added value because it will our assessment will become more coherent and it will be based on the same data. So what we think is that for the underlying transfer of data, even if at this moment it's not completely coherent, we think, yes, there is a need and a possibility, but also a need to come to a common system. The same for transfer and dispersion models. The underlying processes are the same, so okay, there also integration is possible. If we are dealing with the spatial-temporal variation in exposure, except for very specific cases, I don't think that we can, for all the different wildlife, develop the same dedicated system for as we have for human exposure assessment. The same for detailed dosimetric approaches. We are not being concerned about an individual animal. We want to protect the population. So also there, the detailed dosimetric approaches that we have for human impact assessment and human protection, we don't think that they are justified or relevant for an environment risk assessment. And then we have the regulatory limits, consideration levels, benchmarks, screening levels. Because the endpoints are so different, We don't think it either there that we should really integrate. But that doesn't mean we can start with what we can really integrate and where we have the same flow, and then we can have therefore not integrated, but at least comparable flows of how we are going to deal with both human impact assessment and environment risk assessment, but then with the detail that is required for both the assessments, and then bring it together when we are dealing with the multi-criteria risk assessment or impact assessment that is needed for decision support. There is already some form of integration. So the CROM is a model that allows you to impact to assess the impacts to men for a great number of exposure situations. And under the STAR project, there have been some effort to also include environmental impact assessment within CROM. And towards the end of STAR, and we were still working on this, CROM Erica was developed. So that is a system or a tool that allows for within one tool to have an integrated assessment for men and for the environment. So there is certainly progress made in that domain. These are not extremely detailed models. It's more for a first level assessment, but it is a first approach for this integrated risk assessment. So now I come to my last slide, and I would like to acknowledge again the STAR project and the people who were involved in this in the study, and that I can. My presentation is not completely covering the ideas which were expressed there, but it is certainly largely built on it. So thank you.